Welcome. I'm going to turn this off. I hope you turn yours off. I'm Paul Woodruff. I'm the outgoing dean of the School of Undergraduate Studies. I'm here to welcome you to this magnificent hall, this great venue. Just one of the reasons you should be proud of being at the university, the beauty of this hall. I hope you visit it again. There are many fine events here. Another reason for being proud of being at the University of Texas is the high quality of our research faculty, about which you're going to hear more in a moment. Now, this is 2012, an election year. And for most of you, I think this is the first opportunity to vote in a presidential election. And I hope you do vote. I can think of three good reasons for doing it. One of them is, of course, to support and express your support for the candidate of your choice. Another reason is to express your support for the power that you have to vote. That power itself, belonging to a democracy, is something remarkable. It's a power that not everyone in the world enjoys. And a third good reason to go out there and vote is that you have an opportunity to be part of history. I cast my first presidential vote the year that I became old enough to do so. It was 1964. And I wasn't thinking much about it at the time, but I realized that that was a momentous moment in history. That was a moment at which something quite striking happened. And something quite striking and momentous is happening this year too. And you are part of it. And 20, 30, 40, 50 years hence, you can talk about it to younger people. We have at this university faculty who do research, who are discovering or creating knowledge on virtually every subject. And among those subjects is, of course, presidential campaigning. Now, like every subject, presidential campaigning is one that you can study from a number of different perspectives. One reason we have this university lecture series is to allow you to be acquainted with the different kinds of perspectives that we take in our research at the university. So tonight you're going to hear from an historian, a storyteller. You're going to hear from an expert on communication. And you're going to hear from a political scientist who crunches numbers and studies the way data bears on political campaigns. Our first speaker is a wonderful storyteller, Professor H.W. Brands, whose latest story is a book about President and General Grant. So here to entertain and inform us is Professor Bill Brandt.
Thank you, Dean Woodruff. Thank you all for coming this evening. I would like to add a fourth reason why you should vote. And that is that even if you aren't satisfied with the outcome of the election, you will have participated and you will have earned your right to complain. If you don't vote, you really have no right to complain. If you do vote, then you can applaud your candidate if your candidate wins. You can complain if your candidate loses, but nonetheless, you will have participated. Now, how many of you have registered to vote? Show of hands, very good, okay. How many of you know where your polling place is so that on the first Tuesday of November you know where to go? Very good, okay. And you know, of course, that you can also engage in early voting in various places on the UT campus. So do take advantage of the opportunity. My assignment this evening is to talk about the election of this year, 2012, from the perspective of history. Now, I have to confess that I am at a signal disadvantage compared to my colleagues on stage because we historians tend to talk about or should confine ourselves to talking about things that have already happened. And it would be a whole lot easier for me to make some sense regarding the historical importance of the election of 2012 if I knew how it turned out. So if we do this in 2016, could we schedule it after the election rather than before the election? But having said that, I want to give you a few things to think about as you put this election, perhaps, in historical context. Now, the title of my talk is, "It's Always the Economy, Stupid." How many of you know or recognize the reference, where that slogan comes from? I see a few hands. For those of you who know, and for those of you who don't know, it comes from the 1992 presidential election that pitted the incumbent, the elder George Bush, and the challenger, Bill Clinton. And the Clinton campaign decided that its only chance of winning was to focus on the economy, to take the Bush administration, to take President Bush on terms of, say, something like foreign policy, would be a lost cause. The first President Bush's foreign policy was remarkably successful. The United States had helped end the Cold War on terms that favored the United States, and the Bush administration had fought a successful war against Saddam Hussein in the Persian Gulf. So the Bush administration was riding high on foreign policy. The Clinton folks decided that they needed to make a point that the economy was not doing very well. It turned out that it was their good luck, not the Bush administration's good luck, and not the country's good luck, that the economy, in fact, was in recession in 1991. So they focused on the economy, and in fact, they won. Now, this suggests, and on the basis of previous and subsequent elections, it suggests a fundamental principle for evaluating elections. How would you guess, if you had to predict, who's going to win the election this year? Now, we're going to hear in a few moments, I think a bit more, maybe considerably more in detail, about the connection between the economy and political campaigns. But as a first approximation, if you want to know who's going to win, look at the economy. Look at the economy. If the economy is doing well, the incumbent, either the incumbent himself or the incumbent's party, tends to win. If the economy is doing poorly, the incumbents tend to lose. Now, this goes almost to the beginning of American history. You can go back to the 19th century, when the Democrats lost the election of 1840 because the economy was in a slump following the Panic of 1837. You see it again in the 1870s, you see it in the 1890s. Perhaps the most spectacular example occurred in 1932. The stock market crashed, the country went into the Great Depression, and voters wanted to turn out the incumbent Republicans. And if we were trying to figure out who's going to win in 2012 on the basis of the performance of the economy, well, this is one where it's not exactly clear what the economy tells us. Because, and if you've been paying attention to the news and to the campaigns, you'll know that the challengers, the Republicans, Governor Romney's campaign, is saying the economy is doing terribly. And indeed, from a historical perspective, the economy is not doing well. The unemployment rate is over 8%, and normal unemployment is considerably less than that. So on that basis, the challengers should win. On the other hand, the Obama administration and the Democrats are saying, yeah, but things would be a whole lot worse. Okay, so keep that in mind. It's too close to call here, but I'm going to point out something that's ironic about all of this. Presidential elections very often turn on the performance of the economy, but the president has very little control over the economy. And this has been the case from the 19th century. Presidents have more levers to move the economy now than they did back then. But still, it's a very large economy, and though the president is powerful, it really is not going to make a whole lot of difference in this, to cite this election. It's not going to make a whole lot of difference for the performance of the economy whether President Obama or Governor Romney is elected. Okay, I'm going to move from the economy to something else and put this in the sort of a similar category of one of the ironies of presidential politics and presidential history. And that is the question of second terms. Now, I'm going to tell you that historians, political scientists, frequently are asked to rank presidents historically. Who are the great presidents of history? And in those rankings, almost without exception, to make the top 10 or dozen, you have to be a two-term president. Now, one can understand why this is true, because if you get elected, that's good, but if you get reelected, that means that the American people have had a chance to participate in a referendum on your performance. And they said, good going, or at least good enough going to put you back in office. Presidents who run for reelection and fail are, by that means alone, on that ground alone, relegated to the second tier. I happen to think that one of the most underestimated presidents of the 20th century is the first George Bush. But because he ran for re-election and lost, he's going to have a real hard time cracking the top 10. Now, what's so surprising about this, or what's the irony here? The irony is that although only two-term presidents have a chance of being ranked anywhere near the top by people like me, historians and political scientists, second presidential terms almost always turn out badly. It's very hard to find a second term that was a rousing success. Second terms almost always are less successful than first terms. So it makes you wonder why presidents run for re-election. They're simply going to be disappointed. They're going to disappoint their followers. But in this regard, I would just suggest one thing that's sometimes overlooked. And it sort of goes to the question of who runs for president in the first place and why do they do it? There are many reasons for running for president. You want to change the world. You want to implement new policies. You want to speak for the country and all this. But on election day, the election is a popularity contest. And a lot of people are attracted to politics because they like the strokes that come from getting elected. And if you run for re-election and you get elected, re-elected, then you can say, well, I guess they like me. I'm doing a good job. But so what does this mean for the election of 2012? If President Obama is re-elected, shall we expect disappointment? I'm a historian. I don't make predictions. But if the past is any guide, it's hard to see how he's going to accomplish much more in a second term than he did in a first term. Now, a third irony or paradox, and then I'll almost leave you with that, and that is we historians, political scientists, rank the presidents. And at the top, let me ask you if you can guess. There are three presidents that are almost always ranked 1, 2, 3. Not always in the same order. Somebody give me a name. Top three presidents. Yes, that's right. Somebody said George Washington. Somebody said Abraham Lincoln. And somebody said Franklin Roosevelt. Now, in fact, those three presidents top the list almost every time. Washington, because he established precedents. Washington was the father of his country, our country. The two that are most instructive are Abraham Lincoln and Franklin Roosevelt. Lincoln held the country together during the Civil War, saved the Union, freed the slaves. Those are huge accomplishments, and for that reason, Lincoln deserves to be right up there at the top. Franklin Roosevelt guided the country through the worst depression in its history, guided America and the democratic countries to victory over fascism in World War II. So there we have sort of, I'll focus on those, because presidents these days, presidents for the last 50 years, don't really try to emulate George Washington. There's only one George Washington. But they sometimes do think, I could be another Abraham Lincoln. I could be another Franklin Roosevelt. In fact, I would propose that, I'm not going to say most presidents, but a lot of presidents think in terms of transforming the country the way Lincoln did. I mean, maybe on different issues, and the way Roosevelt did. But here's where they should be brought up short against the lesson of history. And the lesson is this. It's one of the fundamental paradoxes of American politics, especially American presidential political history, and that is that the greatest presidents presided over the worst times. Abraham Lincoln was president during the Civil War. This was the great disaster of American democracy. Franklin Roosevelt was president during the Great Depression, the worst depression, the worst economic stretch the country has ever experienced. And World War II, this was the worst war in world history. Now, is there a connection here? I would suggest that there is a connection. The American political system, for all its faults, has a sort of, I'm going to call maybe a mediocre genius for muddling through. Rarely are big changes made because rarely are big changes called for. And if you think about it for a minute, whatever your complaints might be about politics, whether today or in the past, if you look at the United States, just the history of the United States against the broad history of the world, the United States has been a roaring success. You know, never have so many people achieved such a standard of living and such a degree of individual freedom as in this country over the last 200 years. So one shouldn't be surprised that American voters, for the most part, opt to just keep the status quo going, kick the can a little bit down the road. It's only on rare occasions that something big comes up that requires a president to lead the country in some fundamentally new direction. So, Lincoln, during the Civil War, the country was falling apart. Big changes needed to be made. Major initiatives, great leadership had to be exhibited. Same thing with Franklin Roosevelt and the Great Depression. Now, will President Obama, if reelected, will Governor Romney, if elected, rise to the ranks of a Lincoln or a Roosevelt? You better hope not. Because if either one does, what that means is that the country will experience some crisis comparable to the Civil War, some crisis comparable to the Great Depression. And we don't want to see that. So I guess maybe the lesson here would be, hope your presidents don't become too heroic, because their historical reputation is often in inverse proportion to the peace and prosperity of the country. I will leave you with one last thought, and that is, we make too much of presidents. Presidents are far less powerful than we often imagine they will be. In this election, as in most elections, who wins control of Congress is at least as important as who wins the presidency. If you look at presidents in the past, who have moved the country in some dramatic new direction. It could be Lincoln, it could be Franklin Roosevelt, it could be Lyndon Johnson during the 1960s, Ronald Reagan during the 1980s. They have been able to do so only with the cooperation of Congress. So whoever is elected president, that will give us some indication of where the country is going to go. But the country's going to go there only if that president has a cooperative Congress. Thank you very much. In November, get out and vote.
Thank you, Bill. That was wonderful. I learned something. I learned more than one thing, in fact. Our next speaker is Professor Regina Lawrence, who directs the Annette Strauss Institute for Civic Life. She'll tell you a bit more about what that is, I think, but she's an expert on political communication. And I'll be interested in learning from her a little bit about what all this money means that's sloshing around in the electoral process. So,
thank you.
Professor Regina Lawrence.
Thank you. Thank you all for being here. This is wonderful, and I'm glad to be here too. We were given a question, kind of a prompt to think about to prepare for tonight, and the question was, what do we think in the year 2020 that scholars in our field will be thinking about and looking at when they look back at the election of 2012? In my field, the field of political science and political communication, I'm going to talk tonight about two things that I think they'll be looking back at. One that I think is pretty certain, the other of which I'm wondering about. The thing that I think is certain is that scholars in 2020 will look back on 2012 as a turning point year in terms of money in presidential politics. The thing I'm wondering about is how will they look back at 2012 in terms of voter participation and sort of the future of citizenship, particularly among people in your age group. So let's start with the question of money in politics. Money has, of course, always played a role in our political system, but this year is setting records in terms of the amounts of money, as you put it, slushing through the system. Why is that the case? Well, the simple answer is a Supreme Court decision you might have heard of that people are referring to as simply Citizens United. It was a complicated case, but in essence what it did was to lift the federal ban on spending by corporations and unions in presidential elections. And so it has allowed the so-called super PACs, the spending arms of corporations and unions, to spend virtually unlimited amounts of money advocating for or against the presidential candidates. So just to give you an idea of how much money is slushing around in the system today, Kantar Media, which is one of the leading authorities tracking political advertising and spending, has predicted that by Election Day, we will have seen $1.1 billion spent in the presidential election, primarily, of course, on advertising. In fact, they observed in early August what they called the unprecedented nature of this air war, with more money flowing from more deep-pocketed advertisers into fewer markets. And by fewer markets, what they were referring to is the fact that this election is really boiling down to about 8 or 9 so-called swing states or battleground states. Those are the states where the campaigns have decided that the margins are close enough that they're going to get in there, they're going to battle it out, they're going to try to pick off a few voters, bring along a few undecided voters. And so this means that that $1.1 billion is not being blanketed across the whole 50 states. Instead, it's really being concentrated in only 8 or 9 states, places like Florida, Colorado, Ohio. And you can imagine what it's like to be a television viewer in those states. They must be sick of it already. You may have noticed that Texas is not considered a battleground state, and so you may not be seeing as many of those political advertisements. Texas has been Republican, expected to vote Republican in this election, and so in a sense the campaigns have decided that your vote isn't as important to them. They're not going to battle over it the way that they will battle over the votes of people in some of those other states. So what does all of this money buy? If we look at the first slide here, you can get a sense of how the money is being spent. Of course, on advertising, about $450 million has been spent so far in the presidential election on television ads and also internet ads, which are becoming a major force these days as well. Two things we should note about these advertisements. First of all, they are overwhelmingly negative ads. About 80% of the ads that are being aired in this election so far have been negative ads. Now, there are negative ads and negative ads. There's what we call a contrast ad that advocates for one candidate and against the other. It says, me, candidate X, I would do this. My opponent, candidate Y, would do things that are terrible. You should vote for me. But there's another kind of ad that we call an attack ad, which simply raises negatives about the opponent or about the undesired candidate. That's primarily what we've seen in this election, is a lot of attack advertising. In fact, Kantar Media, again, tracked the presidential ads aired during the Olympics, and they found that of the 18 ads aired during the Olympics, only one of them was a positive ad, and the rest were negative. The second thing we should note about these ads is that many of them are essentially based on non-factual claims, compressing or distorting timelines, taking things that people have said out of context, essentially misleading, misinforming, innuendo, that sort of thing is what has dominated the advertising landscape. So how does all this money really matter, all of this money being spent on advertising? Luckily, it's not so simple as just he who spends the most money wins. The research shows that there are a lot of factors that actually affect the how effective ads are in swaying voters. And so things like the timing, the context, the kinds of claims that you're making, and also what we voters bring to the screen when we're exposed to those ads. For example, our levels of political knowledge make a difference in how effective those ads are. So it's not a simple story of he who spends the most wins, but the money helps. What the money does is it allows you to flood the airwaves and the internet with these ads, which then in turn drives the news coverage, so that much of the news coverage is essentially covering the same points that you're making in your ads. And what that buys you is an ability to dominate the discussion, to make the discussion about certain kinds of points, and essentially to distract attention from other things that we might be discussing. So in 2020, I think that the scholars will be looking back at 2012, and in terms of money and politics, there'll be sort of two conclusions they might come to. One is that 2012 was a turning point, a watershed, and this level of money in politics became the new normal, the new standard. It's also possible that they'll look back and they'll say 2012 was a year in which enough people were uncomfortable with that amount of money and the way it was being spent, that there was some pushback, there was some reform. We figured out how to get a little control over all of this money being spent. I think either one of those outcomes actually is possible. In terms of the future of voting, if we go to the second slide, I'll give you something to a few things to ponder while I begin with a simple proposition. And that is that citizens are made, not born. And I don't mean that in a legalistic sense. Of course, many of us are born into citizenship of a particular country, and some of us are made citizens through the process of naturalization. So some of us swear an oath of citizenship to our country. Many of us have never been asked to do that. But that's not the kind of citizenship that I'm referring to. Instead, I'm talking about citizenship as a sense of connection to one's nation, one's community, marked by action. So citizenship not just as a state of mind, but as a set of actions that we do on behalf of that connection that we feel. If the most basic action of citizenship is voting, then I think we'd have to say that many young Americans today do not act as citizens. And this is interesting because young people actually comprise a very significant potential voting bloc. We have about 46 million people in this country, ages 18 to 29. We have about 39 million senior citizens. Now, we hear a lot about the role of senior citizens in politics, right? In fact, the 2010 midterm elections were in part an outcome of strong turnout by senior citizens in that election. Over 20% of the U.S. population today is ages 18 to 29. In fact, Texas ranks fifth in terms of the proportion of our population that's in that age group. So this is a very large, potentially very significant group of voters. And if we look at the next slide, you'll see that that potential voting bloc swamps the margin of victory or defeat of the candidates in the last election. So if young voters were to really make their voice heard, we have some very interesting electoral outcomes that we've never been able to test, we've never been able to observe or to discover. So the youth vote is today out of proportion. It's out of proportion to the actual population. And if we looked at the next slide, we'll see that the rate of voting among young Americans has inched upward in the last two presidential elections, in 2004 and in 2008. We did see some increases, but even in 2008, when lots of people were talking about the youth vote, that was 51% of your age group, 18 to 29, who turned out to vote. So those numbers suggest to me one of two things. Either young people in your age group don't think of voting as an essential element of citizenship, or some of you don't really see yourselves as citizens. The first possibility is something that political scientists have debated quite a bit, and some have argued that the rest of us need to get with it and get a more expansive definition of citizenship. These scholars say, you know, young people today are engaged citizens. They do turn out. They volunteer in their schools and their communities. They support social causes. They start online discussions. They choose what products to buy or not to buy based on their effects on employees, on the on the environment, etc. They are engaged, some will argue. It's just that they don't see voting as an essential element of being a citizen. Of course, other stodgy political scientists push back, and they say, no, voting is the quintessential act of citizenship. Choosing who will represent us, choosing who will make the policies and the laws that so profoundly shape our lives is an essential act of citizenship that can't be defined away. I'm not going to try to settle that debate for you. I'll invite you to think about where you stand in that particular debate, but at least we're having that debate. At least among ourselves, political science. But the second possibility, I think, hasn't got enough attention. And that is that maybe young people do see voting as an essential element of citizenship, they just don't see themselves as citizens yet. And I get clues to this mindset in my classrooms. If I ask my students questions like, what are you paying attention to in the news? Have you been following the presidential campaign? Are you planning to turn out and vote? And of course, I often get the answer, I'm too busy, and I understand that. There's lots of demands on your time and your attention as college students. But if we push beyond that, I often also get an answer that goes something like this. I don't have the interests yet, the stake in society yet, to prepare me for voting. I don't have a job, or at least not a career-type job yet. I don't have kids that are in schools. I don't have a mortgage. I don't have any of the things that would give me a stake in this election. And so, in a way, it would be premature for me to vote. It would be almost inappropriate for me to vote. I don't feel prepared to take part. And in essence, it doesn't interest me for those reasons. So what an interesting contrast. A potentially enormous group of voters who only about 50% are turning out in the last two elections, contrast that with this mindset that, well, it's really not my time yet to participate. So that says to me that in 2020, the scholars will be looking back at 2012, and they'll be asking questions about the youth vote. They'll be looking at, again, one of two possibilities. The youth vote declined in 2012 relative to the previous two elections, and they'll say, I guess that was a temporary upswing. Or they'll look back and they'll say, youth voting continued. That looks like a real trend, three presidential elections in a row. So let me just quickly try to conclude by bringing these two threads together that I've been talking about tonight, about money and politics on the one hand and the youth vote on the other. If it is the case that citizens are made and not born, then I think we'd have to say that, frankly, our political system is not very conducive to making citizens, at least not to making intelligent and engaged citizens. We make that kind of citizenship perhaps harder than it needs to be, In part, that's, you know, around things like voter registration challenges or maybe knowing where your polling place is on election day. But more than that, it's the quality of the discussion, of the conversation that we're having politically. When the discussion is dominated by money and by the kinds of political, negative, non-factual ads that we've been talking about tonight, that's not a very inviting conversation. That doesn't invite you to take part. And frankly, probably for a lot of you, it's a turnoff. And so I think from, in my mind, a really important question is, what will happen in 2012? Will we look back and say that, in a sense, all of that money was misspent and that participation went down? Or, and this is what I personally would hope, will we look back and say, smart young people realized that they do have an interest, they do have a stake in this election, and despite the fact that the political system is not very good at inviting them in, despite the fact that this conversation is not a welcoming conversation for many of you, because face it, many times politicians barely even talk to you, in spite of that, young people turned out in greater numbers to vote. Thank you.
Thank you, Regina. I learned from that, too. Our third and final speaker is Professor Daron Shaw from the Department of Government, a political scientist who crunches data to predict results, a man who's been involved in political campaigns himself as an analyst and has a great deal to tell us. So, Professor Daron Shaw.
Thank you. Thank you. I appreciate the opportunity to talk to you all this evening. I wanted to pick up on something Professor Brands mentioned earlier about presidential rankings. I've always been a Lincoln guy myself, but I was in a sort of a debate with a friend who was arguing for Roosevelt, that Roosevelt ought to be at the top of the list. And he did hit me with something I had a hard time dealing with. You know, I've made the case for Lincoln, and he said, that's all true, but Roosevelt was in a wheelchair smoking six packs a day fighting Hitler. And I kind of thought, well, you know, it's sort of hard to top that. So for those of you interested in those sorts of debates, you might want to keep that in mind. As Professor Lawrence mentioned, we were tasked with sort of a provocative question here tonight. What will, in my case, political scientists or journalists or pundits in 2020 say about the 2012 election? And I guess, so I decided to approach this by saying, you know, what we need to do to understand that is to understand what is it that we think we know about presidential elections and presidential election campaigns in 2012, right? I mean, if you don't know what the conventional wisdom is, it's hard to figure out whether or not the election conforms to it or not, right? So let me concentrate on those things and then use that as a jumping off point for talking about what we might learn. And it occurred to me there are three things that we think we know in political science about presidential elections. The first is that party identification explains a majority of variance in people's votes. The second is that economic perceptions also have a significant impact on how people will vote in a given election. And the third, and this may come as a surprise to you all, we don't think that presidential campaigns matter very much. Now, I actually take issue with that third claim, but I'll treat them each in turn. So let's start with party ID. Just for definitional purposes, party identification is not registration, it's not how you vote, although it's correlated very highly with both of those things. It's essentially a function, it's an attitude that we measure with survey research question. So I'll basically give you an idea about how we construct it and then go from there. So I'm gonna need some guinea pigs here. There are two questions that we ask to determine party ID. The first is, I'll take, if you don't mind, you in the front row. You can lie, I don't care, right? Just answer the question. So, generally speaking, do you consider yourself a Republican, a Democrat, or don't you consider yourself either?
Democrat.
Democrat, okay. That's known as the direction question. Okay, so she says she's a Democrat. So the follow-up question would be, do you consider yourself a strong or a not-so-strong Democrat?
Pretty strong.
Strong. Okay, so that's, you can either be strong or not so strong, right? And if she's a Republican or someone's a Republican, be strong or not so strong on the other side of the scale. Now, give me an independent here in the first rows where I can actually see people. All right, who's an independent? Come on, thank you very much. Okay, so if you say you're an independent, the follow-up question isn't strength, obviously. It would be the following. Generally speaking, would you say that you lean closer to the Democrats, lean closer to the Republicans, or don't you lean either way?
Lean closer to the Democrats.
lean closer to the Democrats. Now, this is the dirty secret. Most news organizations will report the number of independents based on that first question. And that's about 30 to 40% of the electorate. But if I ask that lean question, so you say you lean Democratic, there's a 75% chance he's going to vote for Obama in this election. You're not really an independent, no offense, okay? But if I had to put money on it, and I often do, I would guess, and I would be right 3 out of 4 times, that you're going to vote for Obama. And again, that's no aspersions on people who are independents. But so we end up with this scale running from strong Democrat to weak to lean Democrat. Then our what we call the pure independents in the middle, lean Republican, weak Republican, strong Republican. So it's a nice 7-point scale. It's incredibly predictive of the vote. I'm one of the few people, probably in the United States at this point, who actually will defend party identification. The reason, as I said, it's an attitude. It tends to be socialized. You're not going to like this. It tends to be socialized so that you probably pick up a lot of these cues from your environment. So your parents, your school teachers, peers, these sorts of things, they have an enormous impact on your party identification. I know a lot of you don't want to hear that, but it's kind of the way it is. The apple does not fall far from the tree. I actually think it's incredibly useful. We have, if you go online, you can find these little metrics. You go on a website, and it'll ask you your position on a range of issues, and then it'll map you to the candidate you are supposed to prefer. An inordinate amount of the time, that mapping will tell you that you should choose the candidate who's the same partisanship as you. In other words, party serves as a shortcut. It provides information that helps us to figure out where we ought to be when it comes to vote choice. And you know, when it comes to the presidential election, we have a lot of information, right? We could not go with our partisanship, but probably do a pretty good job. But when you start going down ballot, Senate, Gov, House race, Justice of the Peace, dog catcher, you don't have a lot of information at those lower level races, and I would argue that party ID is not an inefficient way to make a reasonable vote choice. So for those of you who want to vote your party, you have permission. That's okay, right? We're all right with it. Now, we could argue about whether there is actually a Republican or Democratic way to catch dogs. I would suggest that Republicans would probably want to ruthlessly punish them and Democrats would want to rehabilitate them or something. But so, you know, maybe it's not that useful, but it's reasonable information upon which to draw. In presidential elections, you can explain roughly 70% of the variance in presidential voting in the electorate as a whole just using party ID. And if you guys look at the numbers you see posted online, basically 90% of Democrats say they're going to vote for Obama and 90% of Republicans say they're going to vote for Romney at this point, right? So there's this very strong structure to voting that exists right now, right? And is that going to change in this election? Are Democrats, Republicans going to bolt and vote for the other? I sincerely doubt it, right? So I think that will hold. I think we're right on that, and that will persist. The second thing I mentioned is that economic voting or economic perceptions play a large role in shaping the vote as well. All right, so if we know something about the effects of party, what about, you know, whether it's 30% or 10 to 12%, what about those people with no party identification? What can we say about them? And what we know about people who, actually this goes for partisans as well, but certainly for independents. Voters in the United States generally don't really know that much about politics. They're not that interested. They're not that engaged. They don't have detailed grasp of the issues. They're looking for ways to construct a reasonable vote choice. And the economy provides a powerful piece of information. And it works in the following way, and it's not terribly complex. If you're looking, especially if there's an incumbent running for re-election, you know, past is prologue. And so the question is, you know, if I want to make an assessment about whether Obama will be a good president, you know, in the next 4 years, I look to his performance in the previous 4 years. And economic performance is something that seems to provide a lot of information for voters. So if I think the economy's been doing well, you know, why not give him, you know, the keys to the car for another 4 years? If I think the economy has been doing poorly, maybe it's time to vote for somebody else. All right, this collectively, there's a couple things to mention. The first is this is the essence of the question that the Republicans were asking and the Democrats have been responding to: are you better off than you were 4 years ago? And it's known in the discipline in political science as retrospective voting. Right? So I use my retrospective appraisals of the economy as a way to inform my decision moving forward. All right, now that's a long-winded way of saying that, you know, the economy matters, And that in this election in 2012, most predictions based on economic performance are not particularly favorable for the president. Now, there's a lot of reasons why it may not pan out that Obama is held accountable for that, but if you look at models of the vote based purely on economic performance, President Obama is not predicted to win re-election based on those models. All right, so interesting then, the second point, you know, the economy serves as an important piece of information, you know, beyond party. It'll be interesting to see what we say about the 2012 election in 8 years. Okay, now the third sort of piece of conventional wisdom is that campaigns don't matter. I overstate that a little bit, but let me explain the logic. I don't think anybody in political science argues that in congressional races or in a mayoral race or local council elections, that campaigns don't matter. You know, if I outspend you $1 million to 10, I will probably beat you, unless I am utterly incompetent. However, that's not what happens in presidential elections. In presidential elections, you don't have massive inequalities, well, we did in 2008, but that's a separate story, of resources, right? Mitt Romney has a lot, he certainly has enough money to make his case. President Obama has enough money to make his case. So you have a rough equality of resources. You have a rough equality of expertise. Right? The Democrats have their consultants and pollsters, the Republicans have theirs. They're looking at roughly the same information. Right? They have the same sort of techniques to reach out to voters. This isn't, you know, there aren't massive discrepancies in the expertise and professionalism of the Democrats versus the Republicans. Those discrepancies can exist down ballot, but the presidential race, which is the big enchilada, both sides are maximally incentivized to bring their major resources, major players to the fore, and they typically do. So, and again, I'm giving you the conventional wisdom in political science. So the argument is they fight to a draw. And whatever external reality exists dictates who wins the election. So you can't really get beyond objective circumstances. Right? So Walter Mondale couldn't convince people that, you know, he should be elected over Reagan in 94. Bob Dole could not convince people he should be elected over Bill Clinton in 1996. Even though they may have ran entirely competent, you know, sort of nice campaigns, they were constrained. There was only so much they could do. Right now, I think that conventional wisdom is overstated for a couple of reasons. My sense is that while it's true in a general sense that Republicans and Democrats are kind of equally expert, in a particular election, one side, it seems to me, could do much better than the other. I think in recent elections, I remember there was a line by James Carville, who was Bill Clinton's top political consultant in 1992. And the media were sort of throwing rose petals at Carville's feet after the election about what a brilliant campaign strategist he was. And Carville, for those of you who have ever seen him, he's very funny. And he basically said a monkey could have won that election. He said that was an easy race. And the media responded, I remember a reporter said, well, what do you think then is a good campaign? If Clinton 92 wasn't a good campaign, what was? And he said, Gerald Ford's campaign in 1976. And they said, well, Ford lost. He said, Gerald Ford pardoned Richard Nixon, had double-digit inflation, high levels of unemployment, had no skills as a campaigner, and yet ended up closing what in the summer was a 30-point Carter edge to about a point and a half by election day. He said that was a brilliant campaign. I tend to agree with Carville. I think the metrics by which we judge these things are a little off, and that they can make a difference in a given election cycle. So the Republicans and Democrats, I think, on the whole are fairly equal. But it's not clear to me you're not going to see a substantial edge going to one side or the other in a given campaign. So as I said, I'm representing a minority point of view. Most political scientists will tell you, you know, basically the campaigns in a presidential race don't really matter all that much. All right, so these are the three pieces of wisdom: party ID, the economy, and the campaign. Where are we headed? You know, what do I think we're going to see in 8 years as we look back on 2012? Let me suggest a couple things. Party IDs, I think, is going to be confirmed. We're going to find that party drives vote just like it always does, maybe even more so this year. It seems to be that both sides are kind of polarized and partisans are already in place. The economy, this is a tougher one. Obama should be losing if you just go by the aggregate macroeconomic indicators that are out there today, whether it's unemployment rate or real disposable income, or even change in real disposable income, he should be in more trouble than he seems to be. I have a little theory about this. I think that the proliferation of cable news and blogs has basically allowed people to search out economic information that fits their partisan predispositions. In other words, I can find whatever economic indicators I want that conform to my party. And I'm not going to push this, but this is my kind of pet theory. At some point, I'll get data and I'll bore you with it at another time. But if I want to convince myself the economy's good, I go to MSNBC or HuffPost, and lo and behold, the economy is good, just like I thought. If I think it stinks, you know, I listen to Rush. I go to Fox News. See, it stinks. I knew it. It's also the case, I think, that the economy is more complex now than it used to be. And the number of indicators we have is unbelievable. It used to be, you know, in the 80s when I was sitting in your positions, actually not actually there, but at another university, what I would listen to is, you know, what's the unemployment rate, what's inflation? You know, and now we have gas prices, inflation, consumer confidence index, stock indices, there's all sorts of different indicators, and as you guys probably know, some of them are up, some of them are still down. There is more information, and so we can pick and choose, and we have outlets that allow us to do that. The third piece of conventional wisdom, campaigns. I tell you, if you look at the news right now, the president is winning. The president is up 3 to 4 points nationally. He's probably bumping up over 300 electoral votes. 270 is what you need to win a majority. In my opinion, he is overachieving given external reality. And I would argue that's because of his campaign. I think they're running a better campaign right now than the Romney people. It's more coherent, it's more thematic, it plays to his strengths, and I think it was manifest in the two conventions. Now, I won't quantify that, although I could, but I would leave you with, I think in 8 years, we may look back and say, you know, geez, how did Romney lose that race? You know, he did have a lot of factors in play that probably should have done pretty well for him, and it didn't seem to have come out, all right? So with that, I'll let you out, because I think I'm the only thing keeping you from leaving, so I appreciate your attention.
Well, we've all learned a lot, and I hope that in 8 years or 20 years we look back on this and cast our own verdicts, but I hope that come November you cast your vote. Thank you very much for being here. Enjoy the semester. Let's thank our speakers.